Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Game number three of our opening best of three series here for the European pre-qualifier for the Summit 3. Oh boy, it's come down to a best of one, and what seemed like it might be a 2-0 stomp after game one has turned into quite the fruitful series. I'm Ziori, joined again by Coddle Guy. Dakota, this feels like anyone's series for the taking after seeing that second game where Hellraisers just threw it all away.
I'm sure most people out there will consider it a fluke, maybe. Hellraisers just kind of, quote, threw that one away, especially with the weird little Shadow Fiend buyback. And at that point, 4Acres just had enough momentum built up that they kind of just took control of the game. But with that said, we're back square even. Winner of this one moves on. Loser goes home. I mean, what a crazy story it would be if Hellraisers coming in as such huge favorites were to go down to a measly little 4Acres on their small little rowboat. That'd be pretty ridiculous. But here we go. Draft at hand. They prioritize for the third time straight getting a hold of their precious Enigma within the first wave. Hellraisers open up with a Rubik grab. Of all the grabs, that is pretty peculiar to me. It's just like, hey, you know what? Screw you, Enigma. I want
that. Now, wasn't this... I may be confusing teams again, Dakota, because Lord knows that I do that a lot, but wasn't HR the team that was running a lot of a Rubik in Star Ladder and like even first picking it a lot? There was one standout team that was doing
Empire,
such things.
Aloha Dance Rubik.
Oh, it was the Aloha Dance Rubik. See, I'm glad you're here, man, because I would have had that confused. They have been playing a fair bit of Rubik, though. It is a hero and close to the top of their list of most played heroes on this patch. But it is a strange opening pick. Maybe this go-around feeling like they need something to deal with the Enigma, because, again, the 4Acres, first pick Enigma. This is now three games in a row that they've gone with this first pick Enigma. And worked for him once. Was a disaster once, and now we'll see about game three. This will be the decider.
Now it's Hellraisers going for Sniper here. They don't have the advantage of grabbing up their Shadow Fiend again, and you know, it was last game. Unfortunately, that precious FO Ninja prestigious undefeated record now squashed. Measly little 12-1, but still extremely impressive nonetheless. But this time he's going to have his chance working with Sniper, but Storm Spirit going to be the immediate response as far as gap closing, being able to get a hold of that little ugly freak. And they still have the option of getting a hold of something. No holds barred here. And they still have the option of picking up like a clockwork for their own offlane grab. So Sniper is a very popular grab. But the thing is, you pick it up early, there's still a lot of counters out there.
Yeah, definitely right. Storm Spirit is even just one of them. We saw it earlier in this series. How well Storm Spirit can do against the Sniper, but I think the roles were reversed. Was it game one, Hellraisers? Didn't they pick a Storm? And there was a Sniper on the other side? Huh? Now my memory's working.
Yep.
Anybody with those long-range gap closers, as we've talked about a couple of times, and Storm certainly fits the bill with those long-range zips. But
so they need to make sure Hellraisers get something to help this Sniper. Maybe a secondary defensive support, maybe some meat, some frontline action, another potential bristleback, someone who can kind of steal the focus away and allow Sniper to be in prime position to really unload those kind of pot shots that can really creep on you. You think you got a fight going your way, and next thing you know, you're just dying one after the other, and you're like, what the hell is going on here? And you look back, and it's a Sniper way outside in the dark just kind of unloading his fury.
Yes, sir. Yes, indeed. And looking at these opening picks, could this be a precursor to what we saw yesterday, Dakota? The black hole on black hole on refreshed black hole madness? We saw three black holes in a single team fight. I certainly did for the first time yesterday. I think a lot of viewers out there as well. There's potential here. It seems like this Enigma not quite so interested in grabbing that refresher as last game indicated, but hey, we can always hope, right?
We can't always hope. Indeed, that was a ridiculous game. And if people out there don't know what we're talking about, you should definitely check it out. It was Fallout European, what was it? It was the grand finals of the European qualifier, a match between Empire taking on
NIP.
NIP, yeah. So that was an excellent match. Game one, game two was a bit more one-sided. But I'll let you guys figure out what the hell actually happened with that. I don't want to spoil too much. But anyway,
there were a lot of black holes. That is the spoiler that we'll give.
Lots of black holes. It was pretty much Dota pornography. Nauseating, pleasurable all at once. But here
Doom.
We go.
Whoa!
Doom. Okay, that says, hey, cool storm you got there. Now we got to do. So this seems like more of an immediate counter pickup. fits the bill if they need like an offlaner, fits the bill if they want some sort of big badass to be on the front lines and draw the attention away from someone like Sniper. Just kind of, you know, checks off all those things on the list.
Yeah, I feel like this is a safety pick for the Hellraisers. This is that classic hero that you can never cross off the docket in terms of realms of possibility of what Hellraisers might do. They love to fourth, fifth pick this Doom if the time feels right, if the mood strikes them. And here, this seems to be a pretty good Doom game. Storm and Enigma, both great targets for the ultimate, and whoever they grab as their carry, probably a good target for the Doom as well. Most likely your Gordiet's hero headed to the off lane, and of course will be relegated to the jungle, get some farm going on, but tends to be the way that the Hellraisers like to do it. Most likely Alpha Ninja on the sniper mid, so that just leaves the Artez hero, who's going to be that safe lane farmer. What do Hellraisers have in mind? And of course their second support, so they'll think about it. Running low on reserve time here, Dakota. About 5 seconds left as they settle on the Tiny. Whoa!
Uh-oh. Four anchors. They still have banning phase to go through here. Secondary support is needed on Hellraisers. A certain Wisp seems to be a potential option, maybe something they consider for that final ban. But we're on to the next picking setup here. We need what it looks like their potential safe lane farmer. A lot of teams like to go for the PA as far as high damage and being able to close the gap, blink striking onto someone like a sniper. But they would still need a more meat on this team, I feel.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely agree with you. Reserve time. For both teams, yeah. Let's see. They'll need a couple of cores here.
What
I'm curious about this
saw
Tiny.
For offlane.
I think Timbersaw could be good here. I'm curious where HR are going to run this Tiny, though. Is this the position of one, as we saw yesterday, like that NIP style where they just went a wispless Tiny, mm-hmm. Era went for that early blink, very mobile, and just snowballed from there? Or is this a four Tiny who's going to be more of a support and they'll go for kind of a scary tri-lane? That's what I'm trying to decipher here. Slark, pretty good in general. Good against the Tiny for the most part. And another core that is a good target for the Doom. So now this is one way to deal with that hero where you can only Doom so many heroes. And sure, maybe you take the Storm out of the fight, but then there's a Slark flying in and, well, there's not much to lock him down and vice versa. So I like this approach from 4ASC, making Doom have to be kind of choosy about his targets.
That's why I like the idea of Timbersaw. Normally you don't want to do a Timbersaw against something like a Doom, but when there's so many targets and only so many Dooms you got to work with, then you're like, what the hell do I do? And he can close the gap. Timber Chain, he could soak in a little early damage. He likes the quick pot shots to Sniper because it gives him the bit of regen, and there's big meat on Doom and Tiny that you can easily burst through, and if they even want to go for a Wisp here, Timbersaw's beautifully good against something like a Wisp, so that is just my scrub opinion. The ban instead is going to be on Tidehunter, rather, a hero we really haven't seen and that people don't really care for. So we'll see if indeed it's going to be the Wisp grab right here from Hellraisers. They do need that secondary support. Seems like the obvious choice, but
it's been
banned
out now.
That's right. So. That's right. It was banned.
See, but that's what makes me a little confused about this Tiny pick is that they must have known that was going to happen. Like, that feels like bait to me. You fourth pick a Tiny, you pretty much know the Wisp is going to be banned out. And there it is, Spirit Breaker. It's a four Tiny. Unless it's a four Spirit Breaker, which I guess is possible, but seems a little bit less likely.
A four Spirit Breaker seems more likely to me, to be honest with you, than a four Tiny. But it's Hellraiser. I mean, this is match point right now. And you put together a draft like this, this is just interesting to me from Hellraisers. But we'll see. This is a very greedy kind of get up here from Hellraiser squad. Whether if it's Tiny or Spirit Breaker on that kind of four position, you know, they all need to make sure they get something. Even Rubik would probably want to at least put together some sort of mobility so that if Enigma shows his face, he wants to get in prime position for the steal. Mm-hmm. Four anchors now need what I imagine being their offlane get up. I'm still all about that Timbersaw, but we'll see if they decide to venture elsewhere. Bristleback's still another option. Could be good for kiting, slowing down the Tiny. They could do an audible, roll Storm in the safe lane, Zyri, I don't know what the hell is going to happen here, to be honest with you.
No, I really don't either. I do like the Timbersaw that you talked about, especially with that extra strength hero. I completely agree. One that I probably would have suggested myself. If they don't want the Timbersaw, where does that leave them? Something like a Clockwork could work against the Sniper, as we've seen, but here they go with the Phoenix. Another nice long-range initiator. You've got that Icarus dive. If you can hit the Sniper with some of those fiery spirits, then, hey, you got an egg coming your way, and, well, can be a little bit hard to deal with, though. I would say, traditionally, Sniper is pretty damn good against Phoenix. That long range tends to be further back from the fight, and usually Phoenix is forced to initiate onto someone else before that. Before you can really focus down the Sniper, and then you've got all sorts of shells coming your way when you're trying to refresh inside your little cocoon there.
But to be honest with you, Hellraisers could have their hands full. I mean, yeah, you're like, okay, well, I just need to focus the egg, and, you know, but if you're standing there firing the egg, you're leaving yourself exposed for engagements from your Storm, from your Enigma to set up a black hole. Slark's probably rummaging around, and if you're busy with them, then Phoenix can get off a full duration egg and no one really cares about it. I have to tell you, between both these teams and their drafts, it's hard to say who really is the clear-cut favorite. It seems pretty unorthodox from the side of Hellraisers, and it is looking like it's going to be a core farming Tiny, whereas Four Anchors have something a bit more clean-cut. The Phoenix pick at the end is definitely a bit spicy there. We have seen it in recent, picked up by a couple of teams like EG and such, where they like to port it together with something like a Treant, where you have that big wombo kind of a factor. But the lockdown of a black hole in an egg is certainly impressive in its own right. So, I don't know, man. Four Anchors have a really nice draft, I gotta say.
I agree with you, good sir. I think this HR lineup is fun. I think it's interesting, but will it work? It is. So, who is on the four here? Oh, wow. This is way different than I would have thought. Dread is the one to actually take the Doom. So, it'll be Artez on a safe lane farming Tiny. Mm. Mad Dog takes the Rubick on support. F and NJ with the Sniper. That one's pretty predictable. Gorietz will go off lane on the Spirit Breaker. So Dread will do this position for Doom moving into the jungle early on. He's got Stout Shield, Ring of Regen. This is curious. Very greedy. I guess against an Enigma, this is kind of your best setup to make it work. Match their greed with greed yourself in the jungle, but This feels risky to me, Dakota.
We do see this from some teams back in DAC. I believe it was eHome or InFlames team, at least, where they will sometimes have just one very selfless support and have the four position be a jungler. You know, they did it with an Axe a couple of times. Maybe HR doing a bit of the same. They could have Dredd just kind of work in the jungle right off the bat and just have Rubick be, well, the ward bitch moving around. That does mean, of course, they can't get too aggressive early on, but really Four Anchors, you're not expecting to get too aggressive early on because they have that Enigma, and they really haven't been aggressive in the past two games, and maybe HR just anticipating more of the same. They could be one step ahead, Four Anchors, as far as their draft goes, but really we'll just have to see as it comes down to execution. There's the sound of the horn, and I'll go ahead and continue on the introductions here after this first
Slark
engagement. There's the charge on the Slark lift. They throw him right back into open arms of Hellraisers, but the pounce, yep, gets him away to the high ground. Secondary Shrapnel's going to slow him down a bit. This could be a long-winded chase for a kill they might not even get, and time away from those first couple of creep waves. But he is able to make his way bottom. The second charge is going to be there. Thank you very much for that new reduced cooldown. And ultimately, has he got the second bounce? This is space right now.
He's got another pounce. No TP scroll. Look at this spotty devil.
Suckers.
Oh, my gosh. He has to chew through a lot of regen. He eats a salve, so I think it's still a victory for the Radiant, but hashtag space created indeed, sir. That was pretty impressive. Okay. So, introductions. Well, that's where we were at.
Yeah, great. So Nemphy, mid lane, representing ponytailed Storm Spirit. Top, where we're seeing most of the frisky action. Once more, lift back onto Boogie, who's playing her Skywrath Mage. Salami, I don't want to try it, all right? And he's going to be playing your Slark here. Does manage to narrowly escape what could have been potential first blood. Bottom lane, it's going to be Kalu, or I believe it's Matumba Man.
Kalu, it's Trixie or Matumba Man. I don't know. They're playing with their tags. I've tried to decipher it through Twitch chat. They've been no help. Thank you, Twitch chat, for being constructive per usual. I was told that it was Trixie, I was told it's Matumba Man, and I was also told that I'm an idiot. So all of those are news to me, and I'm not sure who that actually is. But wow, this mid lane looks a little rough for the
The
ponytail boy. Pony boy
he
here.
He came into this with very little regen. you know, maybe just one or two shared, it must have been two shared tangos trying to go for the bottle rush. Sniper sees that and is like, I'm just going to hit him with a lot of damage. Look at Mad Dog. Goes on the aggressive. This could be it. And it is. Ooh. First blood for Afro Ninja. He reads this lane so well. Knows that with the lack of regen, he can go very, very aggressive on this Storm Spirit. Forces him to go into the early tango. And at that point, really just kind of takes control. So this is a huge boost for him. And he should be able to really hold strong here in the mid lane.
Yes, sir. Good start for the Hellraisers. And yeah, Afro Ninja now, he's going to be a monster. Gets that first blood gold and now can just control the mid lane. It's a two-faceted win. He was already dominating on the Storm, and now he's dominating all over that fallen corpse. Dread started in that aggro try, now moved into the jungle, and we'll just get to farming here. He's picked up a Dark Troll so he can raise the dead. Look at these little skeleton babies helping him kill these giant wolves.
Yep, so jungle on jungle from both sides. Neither team had even bothered adventuring too early to oppose the jungle. And, you know, Hellraisers haven't done it any of the three games from what I've seen. Valix now, Dire side is pretty much Enigma's dreamland. I think it's like, what? What's the standard? Like, it's level 7 at 5 minutes 30 seconds.
Usually on Dire side, you can keep up with the mid lane if it's like an even farm fest, you know, no one's died yet. So that's a pretty good metric. When they ding 6, you should be pretty much there. Enigma just hits level 5. Afro Ninja will be 5 after one more creep kill. So whatever
that
metric ends up being.
At 3 minutes, and Sniper got a kill.
Yeah.
So Valix is on good tempo right now.
A little bit ahead of him. Yeah, he's really having he's living the dream. And this is that trifecta of camps. You can just keep moving around this nice little circle, cut down the trees, and oh, it's just so great.
So not too bad. He has a good jungle to work with in conjunction, or at least a counter to where Sniper has an early boost in the mid lane. Let's talk about bottom here. Artez on his Tiny, the Wispless Tiny, which we saw work pretty successfully for Ninjas in Pajamas yesterday for the most part. But now, you know, he's got free roam to work with. Phoenix wants to contest Mad Dog here with the pull, so he's going to go toe-to-toe with him. And with these spirits, it's going to slow him down. It forces Artez away from the lane. There's going to be Telekinesis and the stun, but does not have the mana for the throw. Only 85 mana. Kalu's going to salve up and just fly away, but here comes the charge. There's going to be the Fadebolt Zap. Cancels it. Tread, hi, how you doing there? Here's my stomp. Here's my sword. You're dead.
Well, fight fire with fire, I guess. The Fiery Sword of Doom secures the kill on the bird. And whoa, mid lane, that's a charge now onto Nemphy. Goryeot's getting very aggressive. Shrapnel raining down from the skies to try and make some space for him. Bollix, level 6, black hole at the ready. Can he get a black hole onto the tower? Well, he could have, but he's going to choose not to. Boogie just walking through the middle of the frame. Mad Dog dies to the damage over time. Now Boogie gets charged, assassinated. It's a 1-for-1 as they trade supports, but uh-oh, it's not over yet. Fiery Spirits bringing down Afro Ninja. That's a 2-for-1 as the 4 anchors take a fight in the mid lane. Nicely done as Enigma pokes his head out of the jungle.
All right. A lot of action happening early here. Right around that mid lane, 3-2. CS still advantage for that Enigma. Slark right behind. He's been pretty patient here working with the top lane, unlike Artez on bottom, who's had to kind of deal with this Phoenix here and there. Slark has had free roam to do what the hell he wants. And the second he's able to throw together what could be an early Midas, gets that mobility item. But yeah, mid lane, they're getting the charge out. Nemphy could be in trouble here. Very low on life and mana. Gonna force up the rotation. If he could hide in the trees, might be able to get away. But there's the shot on the back, but does get the XP from the Spirit Breaker kill first before he goes down. Mad Dog could be the trade in exchange. Boogie has enough mana for another Arcane Boulder too. Can he get it? There's one auto attack. Gets it done. Double kill for Boogie.
All right, 4ASC striking back here, regaining a lot of lost footing from the initial parts of this laning stage, and look at that gold graph. That's 1,500 net worth in favor of the Dire, nearly 2,000 XP to boot. Meanwhile, in the top lane, this sneaky little bandit, the fish, Mr. Slark, rocking the shark head, he's just farming. What's that coming out on the courier? That's a Midas. He's got the recipe, and we're looking at maybe a 6:30, something like that, just shy of the 6-minute mark. Hand to Midas. He's living the dream. Back to the bottom lane now. Artez initiated on Kalu. He's going to go down first. Actually, the Tiny will fall in trade. So a 1-for-1 is Nemphy zipping around. Now he finds the Mad Dog himself. He's got a yellow stripe on him. He thought he had the kill, and now Mad Dog running behind the tower. Nemphy, he wants it. I can see that ponytail coming from a mile away. The Fade Bolt, is it enough to save the Mad Dog? It is not. The overcharge is there. Overload, rather. Now Nemphy makes the escape.
No one TPing. Goriot's making the charge, the long one from the top of the world to the bottom here, but he doesn't have a TP
on hand.
Who's going
to TP, though? You got Alpha Ninja in the mid. He needs to farm. True. You got Dredd in the jungle who's losing to neutrals. He doesn't have a TP. Then outside of that, it's, you know, it's Artez, and he was dead.
Yeah. Maybe Goriot's crosses paths with Nemphy. Nemphy gonna be spotted. He has no mana to work with here. But here's Phoenix. Icarus dive. He wants to go to the low ground. Duke it out with Afo Ninja. Egg's gonna be popped. And he's like, I gotta get the hell back. I'm getting roasted up. And he will. It's enough to kind of zone them away from any sort of onslaught. There's gonna be the Icarus dive on forward. Oh, goes the wrong way. And okay. Sniper will manage to weasel his way from any sort of hostile action.
I mean, I look at all of this, and this is just space created for Slark. Yeah, Tiny's farming a little bit right now, but they just ganked him. He just died. Slark is actually free-farming with a Midas, and we've seen what this hero can do if left unchecked, especially in the hands of a player like Illidan. He's the one that comes to mind as he's been playing Slark so much recently. If he goes for like a Midas Shadowblade, has that around the 10-11 minute mark, this will be very difficult for the Hellraisers to deal with, I think, undoubtedly, especially with this Doom not really online yet. He's got the Tranks, he's got the Bassy level 5, but still just trying to get his with Enigma also just farming away in the jungle, closing in on him.
Bottom lane. Ooh. They want Artez, they get him silence, a couple Arcane Bolts, a couple Fort Spirits, and they say, we gotta go. Dredd rotates to the bottom lane, and they don't want any more of this. Oh my god, they toss in Dredd. They want him close for the action. He throws out the Shockwave, gets the kill. Phoenix goes down. Goriot continues his charge, gets Boogie, and it's gonna be a twofer.
Maybe Dredd. Three. Volix, he's here by himself. Three. He's got a black hole. Does he use it? No, he's going to save it for now. TP's coming in aplenty. Volix, this is you. Get the black hole. Oh, he's got Mad Dog. That's all he's going to catch. What a sad story. They get the kill on Dredd. Doom. All right, they'll get Mad Dog, so they get two kills out of it, but potential for more there. Still good for 4ASC. Ends up being kind of a two-for-two trade if you tally it all up, but they did have to rotate some TPs.
I believe he was blinded, so he couldn't see, but if he just, like, went for the Hail Mary black hole right over those trees, he could have had a three-man grab right there.
They were, like, all fogged in the trees. He was right here. He could have gone YOLO. Yeah. That would have been the big play. You see why he would have hesitated. That would have been very embarrassing if he airballed it, but...
Yeah.
Oh, my.
And it's a big game. It's a big game. You don't want to be throwing away black holes like that, so... It's justifiable, but the glorious dream was there. It just unfortunately wasn't a reality in this. But
that was one of those plays that was hard to watch with the map hack knowledge as a caster. Same with Roche. Yeah. Like when you see somebody walk in the pit and he spawns 2 seconds after they leave, it's like, they're right there! Just do it! Oh, but you don't know that. Oh, my Gosu spectator hacks. Okay, fair enough. We'll give you a pass this go-around.
So, as we get everyone back into their formidable lanes and trying to farm it on up, surprisingly, Sniper has found his way back on top for the net worth here. Even without being a Midas and all the space that Slark has had, he's still found a way to just bring in the last hits and a couple of pot shots here and there with his 3-1 record. You know, Hellraiser is not far off from this one, but I have to agree, this Slark will creep on you pretty damn fast. As far as mobility goes, he's finished up that Midas. He's got 600 gold. I wonder if this is going to be a Blink kind of a game or maybe a Shadow Blade kind of a game.
Blink is definitely more standard. I know the Shadow Blade is something Illidan in particular really values on Slark. That's like his go-to build. I'm going to be a hunter in the night and catch people off guard. This game, a lot of tanky heroes. I don't know how easy it'll be for Slark to find solo kills, and that Blink gives you a little more just initiation power in team fights. I have this sneaky suspicion it'll be a Blink kind of game, but time will tell. Alpha Ninja in the mid, he's on the sniper, still the number one farmer in terms of net worth. His team will join him here in the mid as Artez gets a double damage rune, and they'll start to lay into this tier 1 tower. Even Dredd showing his face out of the jungle, had unholy aura, and a Doom ready to rock and roll. Tier 1 tower in the mid lane falls down, but the Dire don't give it up for free. They strike in the bottom, and they will get a tier 1 tower of their own.
So, a 1-for-1 trade, while the core still farms here for 4 anchors, and they see that there's heavy movement towards the top. The charge is there. Slark is going to be safe as he pulls away from the wave. Now about 1,400 gold after that tower grab, plus more CS game. And, well, we're still pretty comfortable here from both sides. Getting ready to the 11-minute mark, 8-8 as things go even. Sniper on top still is net worth, but all the three after, belonging to 4 anchors. This is time now for Storm Spirit to be able to really create that space here for his Slark buddy. And it looks like he's not going with any sort of early Orchid grab this kind of a game. Might just kind of do a bit of what he saw from the Hellraiser side of things and get a Bloodstone.
Yeah. He well may. holding on to that soul ring. We'll see. Fight gonna break out in the top lane, though. It's a smoke rotation from the Dire. They'll go in onto Gordietz. He's only level 5. There's your hop in from Slark. Quick pick on him. Rubick falls as collateral nearby. Phoenix with an egg making it happen. Quick 2-0 as 4ASC move into this tier 1 tower up top. Nice gank rotation, and there you go. Volix using that mech, making it a nice, easy tower kill.
This is going pretty well, I gotta say, for 4 anchors right now. They get that job done. They didn't even have Black Hole available. Now they do, so if another fight is to break out, they shouldn't feel too bad, though. Enigma will need the mana. He actually already opts out from this top. 4 anchors, they don't want to stick around too long. Whoa. Immediate combo from the Dark. Artez is like, hi, how you doing? Throws up, gets rid of the Storm Spirit. Now they go on the hunt here. A slow's going to be popping out from Boogie and some Forge Spirits to try to slow their roll and allow for a safe escape from the 4 anchors group.
Yep. All right, 9-10. They get a nice recovery kill on the Storm Spirit. The Sniper really feels like the saving grace for HR to me right now. He's got that Yasha going with the Ring of Aquila. The full round, the full spread of opening items, but his net worth is pretty damn high. He is the only one on the Radiant in the top 4 of net worth. Everyone else in Strug City a bit. Dread still working on his Midas. I think he has it on the Courier. Yep, he sure does. So 13 minutes, a little bit delayed, but can start finding some recovery farm. Artez is the big one. Power Tread, 1600 gold. I think Blink will be in his future, as we saw yesterday. You really need that mobility when you don't have the Wisp, but it feels like he's just not getting as much momentum as we saw Era get yesterday when we saw that Wispless Tiny really succeed.
Yeah, he was able to throw together a pretty good time Blink Dagger, which Artez could still be going for now, but he is still on constant watch. With people missing off the map on the side of 4 anchors, especially someone like Storm Spirit, you can't feel too comfortable moving in and going for CS, which as you see right now, Artez is just like scared. He's just really scared, which he should be. Look who's close. But top lane at the same moment, not as scared, is Rubick. So he pays the price. He goes down. He dies. It was probably for the better that we didn't see it. But bottom lane, they are going to be able to get a hold of Artez. Nemphy has his Haste rune. He's dancing in and out, avoiding where the sun's going to be coming from. There goes Gorietz onto Valix. Nemphy wants to be able to help him out. There's going to be another strike.
A black hole.
Does he go for the two-man black hole here? Gets the mech off, but here's Dread. Dread, oh, he would love to get a hold of Nemphy with the Doom. So Nephi's like, see you later. Sorry, Valix. You're probably going to die here. Here comes the Assassinate. Ooh. Boom! Afo Ninja gets the kill, ends up being a 1-for-1 trade.
It looked like Dread was actually about to doom that. He had the cast animation, he was raising that sword, and then they finished him off, and you realized, the Assassinate's going to find the kill, but almost a wasted Doom cooldown there for something that was pretty much locked in. Mad Dog again, this time way further back in friendly territory, jumped upon and brought down by a Mystic Flare from old Skywrath Mage. 12-10. There you go.
Slark has his Blink Dagger now. He got his Blink Dagger and already 700 gold. And, well, he's pretty big. So we'll see if it's going to be enough to get a hold of Afo Ninja and kind of shut him down quickly. If he gets over those front lines, if they get distracted, Sniper could lose his life at the drop of a hat. And the next thing you know, things could crumble within Hellraisers. But you can almost say the same for 4 anchors. If they get a bit overzealous and overconfident, they put a lot invested in some of these big ultimates and it doesn't work out, they could be the ones in trouble.
Looks like Bloodstone will be the name of the game for Storm. Good call on that one. He's got the point booster already. Glancing at the gold graph, it's about 3,500 net worth and experience lead for 4ASC. So if they can keep up this tempo, they'll just continue creeping on up into the lead further and further. Tiny getting that Blink Dagger now around the 15-minute mark. The one issue I have with this play style of Tiny, going for the kind of tempo controller, I guess you could call it, with the Blink Dagger, a very old school build, reminds me of the Han days a little bit when we used to see solo mid Tiny. The issue with it is it's all about momentum, and getting a Blink Dagger this late, it's still within that realm of he can blink in, combo down people, but that window is quickly closing, and I feel like if 4FC start having issues with this, they can always just grab some bracers, grab some cloaks. There's always items you can pick up to stop Tiny from getting that quick combo, especially Enigma with a mech just makes his life that much more difficult, and if he doesn't find some kills with this Blink Dagger, that's a big investment that is just not helping his bottom line. Smoke on smoke, Dakota!
Oh, they get off the black hole before Dread can do the Doom, and they're going to annihilate them with the Wombo Egg and Skywrath Ultimate. Unbelievable. Oh, my God. Hellraisers get slaughtered right there, and now they are on the run. There's the Blink going into work. They get a hold of Afo Ninja. 4 anchors could end up dropping down for the urn. He goes down. Triple kill for Phoenix. That is what Ron Burgundy says has escalated quickly.
Yeah, it certainly did. 16-10 now, all of a sudden. It's a big net worth gain for the Anchors, and now they pull firmly into the lead. The snowball on this Slark is getting bigger and bigger as he rolls down that hill, moving right into a Scotty, most likely picks up an ultimate orb now. A good margin ahead of the sniper on net worth, and now everyone else on HR hurting that much more. Feels to me like this Spirit Breaker just hasn't been able to get much done. We've seen Gurdjieff play a much better SB in other matches where he can kind of charge in, zone out the backliners, make the support's lives more difficult. But in this game, he just doesn't have that option. There's too much stuff in his way, too many heroes that can stop him dead in his tracks, and even just trying to charge through the Enigma can be difficult.
Oh my god.
Ball Rubik lightning.
With a stolen ball lightning, steals the DD away in front of Neffy. Now Neffy's going to be charged. He could be in trouble here. The bash, the nether strike, makes it up and above, over in high ground.
The fiery
Icarus
spirits.
Steps back. Trixie jumps in like he wants to make something happen, but Mad Dog just simply goes to the high ground here. But they don't lose anyone. Four Anchors could be able to disperse, but they still have the charge.
Phoenix actually saved him there. Now Slark will dark pact away, toss it on the Doom. He actually gets the Doom off on Slark, but he'll stay in fog. And yeah, that regen.
He's gaining more life than he's losing.
Yeah, he's feeling good, but that was really clutch from the Phoenix, actually hitting the SB with one of the Fire Spirits. You saw that Lantern coming. That probably would have been enough for the kill. Maybe could have even been a bash, but oh, that attack speed, that Lantern's so slow, and that gave the Storm the time he needed to scoot back to safety. Now Artez gets his Blink broken, and he'll be initiated on Blink forward, zip-zap, an easy pick on the Tiny. Things quickly backfiring for the Hellraisers.
Where are the wards, Hellraisers? Where are they? We don't see anything coming on the map right now, and it's cost them. And, well, because of that, that was the big team fight that really broke things open for Four Anchors. They were going into the dark, hoping to make a smoke play happen, and they continue to be in the dark here. And this is an upset slowly being unfolded before our eyes right now. I mean, Four Anchors have a lot of momentum behind them.
That's basically where they have vision right now. That line I just drew on the minimap is where HR have to play around in where it's somewhat safe. They've got that mid lane pushing up a little bit. They did take out that tier 1 tower mid, so that gives them a little bit more control in the mid lane perhaps, but they are flying blind. Then you look at Dire Vision. They've got control of all the lanes. They've got a lane ward down in, well, two of the big ones. That one in the top's about to expire, but good vision across the map, and then one sitting in the jungle at that access point to see if anybody rotates about, maybe makes a move towards the Roche pit. 4ASC are ready to rock and roll. Storm closing in on that Bloodstone. It's a coming. 19 minutes in.
My oh my. So what is the comeback option here for Hellraisers? Your sniper. So putting together some respectable farm, not even at the 1k health threshold yet. And you have a lot of potential here on 4 Anchors to just move past, get a hold of the sniper, get the job done, and get the hell out. Dread, you know, he's trying to be there to kind of lead things off. Who do you doom in this kind of setup? You go for the doom on Storm. You're going to be leaving Enigma wide open to get off the black hole with still Phoenix and Skywrath Mage to complete that full wombo combo factor that we saw in that big team fight earlier. This is a tough game for Hellraisers right now at this point. Hell and 4 Anchors, man, they have a lot of momentum behind them. Looking to secure it here. Hellraiser's just desperate maybe to try to get some towers down and bring some of the gold off that map into the pocket.
Yeah, they need it. Now this gold graph getting close to the five-figure lead for 4ASC. Not quite at that 10,000 mark yet, but quickly getting there. XP at a pretty comparable amount. Blink Dagger now up on the Enigma there, so he's got some long-range initiation. Slark getting very close to his Scotty. We'll pick up maybe a few more pieces here at the secret shop. We'll see what this Red Horn's up to. Yep, there it is. Point booster and Orb of Venom. So, getting close. Meanwhile, in the Radiant Jungle. Oh, the Mad Dog. Ah, oh, jumped on again. There's that Dire Ward coming in handy. They saw him walking on up. And, well, Mad Dog going to get put to sleep once more. Nemphy gets doomed and assassinated. But look at this space creation from the Slark. Now the Supernova comes in. Dread, he's stuck inside of a tether. He's going to get hit by this Phoenix Egg if he's not careful. Oh. Black Hole comes out onto the Doom as well as the Sniper. It's a 3-for-0 trade for ASC. Oh my, they are having a dance party all over the corpses of HR. Now Artez gets isolated. It's a 4-for-0. It might not even be done yet. Gordietz, he's sitting by himself in the lane. If they see him, they may go for it.
Oh my god, Hellraisers are getting beat all over the place at this point. I don't even know where to begin.
Dude, they're getting styled on right now.
They are. This is a very interesting draft. They have thrown themselves into for a match that's elimination for them. And I don't know if it's paid off. Putting so much support into the back of a Rubick, it's clear that maybe it's been too much trouble. They finally have a ward out, but it might be too little too late at this point. And really, the Dread Doom hasn't been too big of a factor. I haven't seen a Doom really be able to shut down anyone on 4 Anchor side. And that whole first quarter, or even a third of a game, this Slark got to do whatever the hell he wanted in that top lane, and he is just reaping in all the benefits now.
Yeah, really not a hero you want to leave unchecked. That's a completed Scotty in his inventory. The Black Halls have been on point from Volix this game. 3 matches in a row. We've seen first pick Enigma out of this team. Doesn't matter what side. If they've got first pick, second pick, they will grab that Enigma right away, unless he has been banned out in that first banning phase. It's a weird way to go about it. Not any other team really doing that right now that I'm aware of. But in this series, at least, it is working for the 4 Anchors. And if you're HR, what do you do at this point? Your Sniper, who was your saving grace, now really falling behind. He's gone for this kind of hybrid build that doesn't really give him too much mobility. Picks up the Yasha on power treads and then goes into a Maelstrom for a little bit of extra creep clear and magic damage. But not really that glass cannon like Mask of Madness. I'm going to do huge damage if I don't get caught in the black hole. But then also not really this survivability-based build. Sure, he gets some stats from the power treads and the Aquila, but I feel like just going glass cannon mobility may have been the name of the game. Even hell, just a blink dagger so he can sit back, wait for the fight to break out, and then position himself accordingly.
I mean, he's still pretty glass to me. It's just the cannon's not as powerful as it should be.
I guess that's true, yeah. He's still made of glass but hasn't assembled the cannon yet. It's the power treads, I guess, that stand out to me as, like, why wouldn't you get the phase boots? I mean, I guess you get a little extra strength, you get a little extra attack speed, but I just like that movement speed on Sniper so you can get in and out a little easier.
It's going to be a struggle, though. Now, easily, uncontested, Orosh is going to be snagged up here from 4 Anchors. Hellraisers might be coming to the realization at this point that their Summit 3 adventure could be coming to a very, very surprising early close as 4 Anchors looking to seal the deal on this one. Already leading out the charge, Slark moving on forward. Deathpack is going to be able to connect onto Artez. Quickly stolen as that pounce, but Artez needs to try to escape, but there's the jump in from Nephi. And they just have so much strong initiation. Mad Dog, oh, can he get the pounce TP? He can. So one survivor will make it out. Goriatz charges himself away, but 4 Anchors now are probably just going to look to claim the tier 2 towers at this point.
Yeah, HR, even though they mitigate their losses, they disengage pretty effectively, they still lose their position 1. That's their tiny. And Phoenix got some items on the ground here. He's got an urn, Rod of Atos, okay, but I feel like this Blink Dagger on Tiny is essentially a wasted slot. And that was kind of the point I was trying to make right when it was picked up. If you're getting initiated on and that you don't get to use the Blink to get away or initiate, it's really just a 2,000 gold sunk cost. It's just sitting there. It doesn't help you at all in these team fights. And it feels like since he picked up that Blink, it's just been nothing but 4 ASC on the aggressive being the ones that initiate on the Tiny. And if you commit to this Blink Dagger, you have to be aggressive. You have to be the initiator and make sure that you don't get caught and make good use of that investment that you made. You know, that's like halfway to an Aghanim's. He could just be cleaving away in the jungle, farming it up, trying to recover, hitting towards critical mass, and instead he went for the riskier play, and it is not paid off. At least not yet. We'll see.
No. And it gets hard. You have to find farm, but really, where is it safe? Where is it safe? This team can just constantly be lurking in the dark, and any sort of maybe potential engagement, I mean, what the hell was that? Dread gets caught out bottom lane. I mean, I'm trying to like analyze the situation and people are just falling all over the place. Nowhere is safe. Dread is pushed way too far deep bottom lane. Gets jumped on. Now they're jumping on the mid. The egg is popped, but hey, ooh, Artez, return of the fire here.
Artez, he walks into the supernova.
Oh boy, oh boy.
Oh my gosh, Dakota, this could quickly implode for HR. Now in the mid, Gordiet's initiated on. He's already used his charge of darkness, channels up another strike, but the laser just zapping him down. Kalu gets another one, 8-3-8. Now the wicked streak sick streak continues. Yep, Artez goes for a combo onto Slark, but not enough damage. He's got just too much damage. This Tiny is paper compared to the Slark.
15k net worth lead and rising for the, what was it, 18% favorites in this best of three series.
Lots of rares going to be won today.
Lots of rares going to be lost for those trying to play it safe. And, well, Shrapnel has a desperate attempt to try to slow them down from taking this tier 2, the last and final outer tower. And still, with Aegis on hand for Nemphy, four anchors could just kind of step back, take a breather, and when everything is ready to go, which pretty much it is, except Valix just needs some mana, they can maybe consider a push on the high ground while they still have so much momentum and so much of an advantage in this game.
Yeah. This is just getting worse and worse for the Hellraisers, and I keep trying to think of something they can do to get back into this game, a smoke rotation, a Roche play, anything, and I don't know what it is at this point. I mean, they just don't really have a great recovery team. You've got, oh, we'll hold that thought up top. Gordiant's initiated on again. He has a charge up in 1 second. Nemphy will not be able to stop him from running away. But you know, Doom, Sniper, Tiny, Spirit Breaker, all heroes that just don't play that well from behind. If they get ahead early, they can stay ahead and really do a lot of damage. But Artez has no item progression. He's got a Bracer now, and that's about it. He's been on Blink Power Treads for at least the past 10 minutes, if not a little bit more.
Yeah, I don't see an Agnum Scepter in his near future. Drums is also going to take a lot of work. But at that point, he's just a big boy. He's hitting hard, but those shots are few and far between. And he could be easily kited about from a team that's so elusive. I just don't see the effectiveness of Tiny in this game right now. It was a questionable pick at the time of the draft. And it's obvious, with still one more ban for each team, you weren't going to get your Wisp Tony.
Yeah.
So they were put into a situation where they got this four-position Doom. It just seemed like a bit of an awkward throw together at the back end of that draft. But here we go. They're able to get a hold of Gorietz. He goes down. More kills being brought in now. You have a huge bounty on the head of your Phoenix, a huge bounty on the head of your Slark. I don't know if they're ever going to get those rewards, though.
Yeah. I still don't know what the general plan was with this fourth pick Tiny. I feel like there's just no way HR were expecting to get Wisp. If that's what they wanted, then the third pick Doom is just not the way to go about it. They could have gotten Tiny Wisp Doom, I think, if they wanted to, by going Tiny Wisp and then fifth pick Doom. That chance in hell, that would have been the final ban. Ugh, this is just tough.
It is. It's tough to watch. Mad Dog gonna get instantly taken care of. It's 27-10. 20k net worth plus. I'm sure if we had a statsman, they say this was like a 0.01 chance of a comeback.
Yeah. Are they even going to defend here? They get the tier 1 tower top. 4ASC just slow sieging the tier 3 down in the bottom. I think they're skeptical that maybe a trap is set. Why is no one coming to defend the base right now? Is there an Aegis still standing? No.
This is just looking like a morally broken HR squad. Maybe can't believe what's happening before our eyes. I'm sure a lot of people are feeling the same way.
Yeah.
Four anchors moving on in. I mean, credit to them. They've had a great lane set up. The game one was obviously not their best showing, but game two and three, I mean, game two, they had that huge comeback. And, well, with game three, they've been pretty much executing a solid draft that they have thrown together. And I don't know.
Well, they get the tier 3 tower. They won't force the issue for now. I think HR definitely have the scarier late game lineup if 4ASC rest on their laurels and just kind of give them space to get back into this game. Sniper now with an SNY getting a little bit beefier, and Doom picks up his Aghanim Scepter after Blink. So they are starting to get some core items. Artez still looking rather poor, but a long way for that to happen, but 4ASC have not won it yet. It's a very, very big gold lead for 30 minutes, big experience lead too, but until they get a lane of barracks, I think HR still have a shot if they turtle up and wait for 4ASC to do something silly, dive the base, get hyper-aggressive. So far, they've been playing with a good degree of control, but you never know. Things can get crazy when you're this far ahead. Slark has gone back for a Lincolns, by the way, so upping his allowed YOLO lot for today, as he now has something to keep him kind of safe.
Hellraisers smoke as they head back into their own jungle, maybe to scout things out, try to take back some farm. And I mean, you are right. Anything can happen. It was in game number two that things got dramatically turned around in the favor of four anchors, but it wasn't this big of an advantage. So it's going to be a much harder task for this experienced squad.
Yeah. Ooh, Basher now out on Slark, and a Scythe of Vice on the Storm Spirit. Look at these big items. Even a Force Staff on Skywrath. Pretty big item here at 30 minutes for this position 5. Double Bloodstone as well. One on the Enigma, one on the Storm. Volix really likes this Bloodstone Enigma build. Second game in a row we've seen it. Ooh, mid lane. Slark. Oh, thinking about it. Not quite yet.
Okay. Nope. But here they go. It's their time. They're looking to kind of put a lid on this game as they charge down from what looks like the north side. Moving, scavenging, HR, they're stuck inside the base, stranded with only little bits of farm for the sniper.
Oh, Dredd.
Complete in 2K, but yeah, Dredd gonna get caught out.
Debut of that scythe, and yeah, it's gonna cost him everything. For HR, or HR, do they have a buyback on the Doom? They don't, so this is 45 seconds of a 5v4, Dakota.
Are they gonna go for it, though? Maybe they wait. Maybe they want to go Roche. Maybe they want to play it safe.
Roche is about to be up. Just coming up. Yeah, will Skywrath be lucky? Oh! That is about as close as you can get to have Roche spawn right behind you. That is...
And he flies back. Guys, it's not up yet. Let's just push.
Yeah. That's really sad. Okay, Slark, he gets assassinated. No Lincolns there. And there will be a glyph for the Radiant. We have to find the right way to initiate this. They may just let the bottom lane fall before they try to take a fight. Doom up in about 5 seconds. Remember, he does not have buyback here. Sniper and Spirit Breaker, the only two with buyback available at the moment.
So there's going to be your first racks dropping.
Playing it very safe, though. Look at that.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a smart way to play it.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
Well, with this, they could adventure back, scout out Roche one more time. They would see it up this time. What? Artez is just like, I'm ready to go.
What are you doing, Artez? What are you doing? Now Mad Dog, he steals the ball, lightning, he'll zip away, but what?
That's Artez, no buyback, out for 40, and now Foranger's like, huh, well, okay, well, let's just go back and finish what we started on bottom lane, I guess.
Wow. Well, that's unfortunate. I don't know if that's Artez just misreading the situation, thinking they were fully retreated back in the well and he was safe, or if that's just Tilt right there. And that's just one of those, I'm gonna go farm, whatever, we already lost. And then just gets picked off. That's what that felt like to me a little more. He's just walking out in front of his team by himself. We'll hold that thought, though, as here we go. Initiation. Doom comes out onto Slark right away. The Phoenix Egg. Slark with still plenty of HP. Gets four-stabbed back. Looks like he'll be able to live and outlast it for now. Out of the range of that Ag's debuff. Now the Spirit Breaker goes down. He'll buy back straight away. And it will be HR to press out of the base. The Doom gets reset on Slark. Maybe enough for a kill? No, not quite. He'll still be all right. They get a collateral kill onto the Skywrath Mage. That'll make it a one-for-one with a buyback utilized. And that'll be the end of it.
But even then, it's still a gold profit for four anchors, still. Not quite enough for them to really take advantage of that rubber band, which is there. I mean, one big fight from Hellraisers, it would definitely would help. Maybe two, maybe three is what it would take to get back in. Four? I don't know. But the thing is just they're a wounded animal at this point. And four anchors would love to take them out back and get the job done. Hellraisers, though, never say die. But at this point, 4Acres have scouted out the Roches up. They want to take the big boy down, have that Aegis. The security of the extra life could help them seal the deal. Mm-hmm. And it looks like that's just kind of what they want to do.
Yeah, this is like when you're like traversing the face of a mountain to hunt some mountain lions, and you slip in some mud, drop your gun, it misaligns your scope, you shoot him in the knee, he limps off, and then you spend your rest of the day just walking around the jungle trying to find this damn injured mountain lion because you feel bad. But you still can't find him. I feel like that's where 4ASC are right now. They've injured him, but they just got to hunt around, find that right opening to deliver that finishing blow. And this Aegis of the Immortal will certainly make that quest a little more easier as Nemphy picks it up again. Uh-oh. Mad Dog. Looks like he's living up to his name here. He'll DC, and HR don't really seem too fazed by it. Okay, he'll come right back.
Okay.
They don't even bother pausing.
I was going to be like, what is happening on that side of the world? Like, okay, they're back in. They're ready to go. Artez is way deep in enemy territory with this Invis rune. Going to be expiring soon. Better consider getting the hell out because Slark's going to blink in. Notice that he's being spotted from something here. He's like, oh, is this... what? What? But luckily, Artez has found a corner to TP out of. He just figures there's probably a ward in the area. But Artez is back. Gets a bit of intel from that. A little bit of side farm. And at this point, four anchors just kind of push the lanes back on forward towards the Hellraiser side. And maybe look to engage.
Yeah. I think they definitely want to fight off this Aegis. And yeah, they will start to group up here. Even Phoenix joining the party. Shivas and Atos. All right, no Midas on the Phoenix. That's interesting as well. Phoenix is usually a hero that is regarded as one like the Invoker, needs XP almost more than items, just to hit that level 16 as quickly as possible, buff up your egg, and get all those yummy stats. Not choosing to do that here, going for more utility items, but that fast Atos has definitely come in handy, and now the Shiva is a great item to have against Tiny, who is severely lacking on attack speed. He's also got an ultimate orb now, so finally some item progression, but it's not really the hard-hitting item that's going to instill fear into the hearts of 4ASC.
Here we go. This could be the final hurrah here. Already down. Arax on the bottom. Nemphy finds himself into a corner. Has that Aegis, of course, to fall back on, so he can go pretty ballsy here. But the right clicks start going out on the tower. They're going to just try to get a couple early pot shots in with the shrapnel and, of course, the assassinate. It's enough to at least fend them back for now. But Nemphy's still in prime position. Black Hole, Phoenix Egg, Skywrath Mage Ultimate. They have the whole kit and caboodle and fireworks get up here. Can they execute?
Rubik, this is you. Can you steal this Black Hole and give them a taste of their own medicine? Can you channel your inner Mary Poppins? This is you, Mad Dog. Here we go. Nemphy jumps over the tree line right onto Afa Ninja. Slark follows up. Nice stun from Tiny to break it up, but it isn't enough. Enigma goes walking in, gets tossed up. Black Hole not being channeled yet. They might not even need it. Two buybacks used straight away. Sniper and Doom go down. Now they lose their Tiny. He is without a buyback. Supernova goes off. Slark focuses on the towers as they go on to Mad Dog. The crazy man himself will get brought down. Assassinate brings out the Aegis. And HR hanging in there for now, but they're not defending the base. There's your Black Hole. It's just on Dread. Rubik's down, so Volok's feeling okay about it. It's a dieback now on Dread. Appa Ninja in danger of a buyback, or dieback of his own. He's already bought back. It's a bloody disaster in the Radiant base, Dakota. That'll be the GG as 4ASC upset the Hellraisers in the first round of the Summit 3 European pre-qualifier.
An upset indeed. Unbelievable stuff. Wasn't expecting that, especially after game number one, where Hellraisers looked so dominant. Game number two, it's a comeback play. Hellraisers, questionable decisions that allowed four anchors to get themselves back in evening series up, and I bet they could now wish they could go back in time and take back that game number two, but that's not the case here. Four anchors have thrown together a pretty solid drafting get-up. Hellraisers, a bit more questionable with the late Tiny grab into a Doom 4 position, and it cost them. Cost them their Summit 3 life, and with that, four anchors move on.
Well, that's the end of it for Hellraisers. First team to be officially eliminated, and that will stop us here. We'll have a break, Dakota. We've got about 45 minutes or so till our next series starts. It will be Power Rangers versus M5. Looks like we've had a little change. It was supposed to be Power Rangers versus Tinker, but it seems there's been an old switcheroony. So more updates about that to come. I got to take a break and talk to my admins, and then we'll give you the final ruling here, but I believe it will be PR versus M5. If you enjoyed the cast, give us a follow on Twitter. I'm at ZayoriTV. He's at CattleGuy, and of course, at Beyond the Summit to stay up to date with all things happening for the Summit 3 and what's going on in the studio. Stick around, folks, because we've got a whole nother Best of 3 series coming your way.